This week, we're in Seward, Alaska for halibut and trophy rockfish. And then we're after Columbia River Gorge smallmouth bass. I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television. Seward, Alaska is the seventh most lucrative fisheries port in the United States, processing around $50 million worth of fish each year, with much of the sport caught fish being processed at J-Dock, where a day's catch of halibut, salmon, or rockfish can be processed immediately. J-Dock's large volume vacuum packers stay busy throughout the spring and summer, handling boatload after boatload of what Alaska is famous for. Before Seward was established in 1903, a Russian fur trading post laid claim to these waters, but now it's all about the fishing. Today we're heading out to experience some fast-paced halibut fishing with Captain Randy Wells, who operates the Seward Fish Company.
So we're going out of Seward Harbor today. We've got a pretty light sea, calling for about 15 knot wind out of the southwest and a 6 foot swell. Resurrection Bay is about 14 miles long. As soon as we leave Resurrection Bay, we'll be in the Gulf of Alaska. We're going to head due east out to a big island out there called Montague Island. That's where the majority of halibut are caught.
The run down Resurrection Bay out to the Gulf of Alaska is a journey through a kaleidoscope of mountain views typical of Alaska. And if you keep your eyes open, mountain goats are a common sight on the sheer cliffs overlooking the entrance to Resurrection Bay. Then it's out to the Gulf of Alaska to Montague Island, where the halibut live.
Halibut, you know, they don't want a muddy bottom. And the way the tide comes right here, this is the head of Prince William Sound, and so the way the tide turns in here, it pushes bait fish. And the halibut will sit right on the slope, and so they'll come up from 700 feet, and then they'll sit right on this slope. So if we can find a spot that's about, you know, between 90 and 160 feet, we'll sit the boat and our bait right on the edge, and when the tide turns, it'll push that procure scent trail right over, and they'll come up and they think they're ambushing the bait. What I do is when I get on top of the spot, I put my cursor right on the stern of my boat, and then I put the boat in neutral and I let it drift, and that's gonna tell me which way the current's pointing. That's gonna tell me, if I compare that with when the tide's gonna turn, that tells me exactly where to position my boat. I've got about 9 holes right through here, and they're all tide and current dependent. Right now we've got about a mile an hour drift on the tide. You can see how the plateau comes up right here from 700 feet was way down here, and then boom, it plateaus out. So I move my cursor right here. That gives me the exact coordinates. This is exactly where I want to drop my anchor. Okay. So if you can see here on the chart, we're currently sitting at about a 200-180 spot right here, and right out here's the deep parts, 500-600 feet. And if I zoom in, this is where I left my cursor, and you can see that we're drifting away from the spot. Well, when I put the boat back on the spot and drop the anchor, our scent trail is going to be drifting to this drop off, and these halibut are sitting right on this drop off. So we've got a perfect tide and a perfect drift for our scent. And anytime you're halibut fishing, not every hole produces fish every day because of that. You've got to have the right drift for your scent trail. So in here I've got salmon carcasses, which we're allowed to use in Alaska, any part, non-edible part of the fish. And we're using whole herring. This green right here is that new Procure chartreuse, which is the pollock and salmon egg oil. Plus I've got some squid oil. It's about a 2-hour boat ride out. I put my frozen herring in, frozen bait in, half fill the bucket with water, and then add my scents. And by the time I get out here, my meat's still firm, but it's absorbed all this glow scent. When you're halibut fishing, this glow scent is key. You gotta have it. So whenever you're halibut fishing, if you can, you always want at least one jig rod out because it's kicking up dirt. It's giving lots of action, and it'll bring the fish to your scent line. So you've got to have at least one jig rod out. The guy jigging will get worn out, so everybody will take turns with it. The jigs typically produce the biggest fish, but you'll also typically lose more fish on a jig because this is a straight J hook, and you're fishing from so deep. Whereas on a typical bait rig, you're fishing with a circle hook. When the fish gets it rolled into his mouth, it's real hard to lose. Whereas with a J hook, they come right off. So.
And Randy, do you have any scent we're going to put on this?
Yeah, we're going to be adding the ProCure scent to that.
This is some butt juice gel that I'm going to put on the jig, and this will stay on about 20 minutes to put down scent.
We got one on the jig too?
Oh, way to go, Jabo!
So we've got how many on right now? Three?
Welcome back to Seward, Alaska. I'm Justin Wolf. We're staying at the Grand Alaska Lodge, where the food is really excellent. Steve Lynch of ProCure, his sons Jake and James, and friends Dave and Dan Girard are lucky to be staying in such a comfortable lodge, as they've had an extremely busy day of halibut fishing with Captain Randy Wells.
Yeah, so that's a good solid 20. So in Southeast Alaska, you're allowed one halibut per person, but up here out of Seward, we're still allowed two halibut per person. This is a good eater. Opening the box. Oh yeah, that's a good one.
That's bad.
Is that a better fish?
Yeah, it is.
Take your time with him. Don't horse him in. If he needs to take line, let him take line. Don't reel against him. It's a big. When you get into a big, powerful fish, if he wants to take it, let him take it.
There you go, that's what we came for. Drop down bottom, bang, bang.
Before long, we've got enough halibut to fill our freezers, and these are the perfect size for eating, as these fillets will be tender and not too thick, just
that's
right for cooking.
For sure.
Back at the Grand Alaskan Lodge, Chef Jake Waterman showed me an easy way to make a halibut appetizer that you should really try.
Oh, that's a good 30 pounder right there.
All right, so you just went out and caught some nice fresh halibut here in Alaska, and I'm gonna show you a way to prepare a nice little appetizer dish for before dinner. So what we've got. Got a little bit of halibut fillet that's been skinned. Take some just olive oil. We're gonna run it right over the top of that. We'll take a little bit of seasoning, which has got ancho chilies, cayenne, paprika, Mexican oregano, thyme, and just liberally coat the fillets. And we're gonna go from right here, right into the oven, 350. And it's usually gonna take about 10 minutes to 20 minutes, depending on the thickness of the fillet. All right, so now that our halibut's done, we're gonna go ahead and throw it in our KitchenAid mixer here, and we're gonna continue to add the rest of our ingredients. Probably about a tablespoon and a half of mayonnaise, the equivalent of sour cream, so just about a tablespoon and a half. And these are green chilies, just get them out of a can. And I'm only gonna put about a tablespoon of those guys in there. A little bit of Colby Jack cheese. And then we're gonna set it on mix. And we're just gonna mix it until it's mixed. You don't wanna break up too much of the fillet. You still want it nice and kinda chunky. Make sure you scoop out all the good stuff there. Spread it around. And then we're gonna coat with the additional Colby Jack cheese. Put under the broiler for about 3 or 4 minutes. I've got my plate set up here with just some crackers, and we're gonna go ahead and set it right in there. Got a little bit of chopped parsley just for garnish, and then at the very end, we're gonna put a little bit of cracked pepper and a touch of salt, and that's it.
They're so good.
That's a good one, but to handle all of this fish, you're going to need a bunch more recipes. Plus, we still need to stop on our way in to get our limits of Alaskan black rock fish.
All the way down?
55, 60 feet, and they're pretty thick. They're real thick. Oh, man. Everybody got fish?
Yeah.
Yep.
I got a big one. Oh. Okay.
Oh, there's a good one.
Oh, that is a nice one right there. Oh, yeah, that is a good one right there. Look at that.
Oh, I got a good one.
That's a big black sea bass right there.
Good one.
You got a lean cod, I bet?
Oh, Dave's got a nice one too.
Oh, nice. Yeah, okay, those are fat right there. Open in the box. Okay, reel them up. Let's go do it again. That's a great spot. It got to be 9 feet deep.
Wow.
So I'm gonna put us. I'm gonna put us right on top of them again. But then pull away so that we don't get sucked on top of that rock. From growing up in Oregon and fishing down there before I came up to Alaska, those of you guys that fish down there, you'll see these diamond jigs at the rockfish stores or at the tackle shops. All I've got going on is two split rings, and then I've got a 7-aught owner sidewasher hook on there. Guys are always asking, what about bait? The only thing I put on here is my Pro-Cure gel, and that's all you need. So you bounce it off the bottom, and to them it looks and smells like a bait fish. Good.
Get a little slack.
Got one.
What's our depth?
Our depth is 24 feet. Open in the box.
We got a double.
Got a double?
Woohoo! Way to go, Jay.
That is trophy class. Alaska black rock fish right there. That's as good as it gets right there.
How much do you think that weighs?
It's in the 6s and 7s right here. Wow. World record's only 7.5, so that's a nice fish.
For information on booking your own trip to Seward, contact Randy Wells at the Seward Fish Company. Call him today or go to fishsewardalaska.com. The Columbia River dominates the Pacific Northwest in all aspects of natural and cultural history. It's also a pretty good place to fish for smallmouth bass. Today we're after Columbia River bass with tournament anglers Jeff Abbott and Marcel Clausen. It's early spring, so Jeff and Marcel are going to start off looking for warmer water in a side pond that's just barely accessible with a bass boat off the main channel of the Columbia. Smallmouth migrate in and out of this pond through this tunnel to spawn, so if the water has warmed up enough, there should be a concentration of bass.
Yeah.
Good,
how about
yourself?
Good, good, how you doing?
Good. Any luck?
No, not yet, just got here.
There goes one.
There we go.
There we go. Switched up to a drop shot. Fished a little bit steeper bank. And I wanted to make sure my bait was soaking in the area. Not that big one, but went down to 6-pound test line. There's been a lot of people fishing in here, so maybe that made the difference. We really ate that. There we go. Little guy. The Columbia River smallmouth really fight. Pound for pound, they are a lot of fun. Using 6-pound P-line fluorocarbon, real strong. I've trusted it for the last 4 years and it's never let me down. What I got going here is a drop shot weight
on a size 4 finesse wide gap Gamagatsu with the 3.5 inch curly tail Saturn worm, and about a foot leader with a 1/4 ounce drop shot weight. And it's just about right with the wind we got here, and the fish are hanging out in about 4 to 5 feet of water. I'm working it kind of fast. Should get a couple more on her.
During the springtime, most of the stuff here is pretty small. There's perch fry, or small perch, small panfish, and then also small sucker fish, other kind of trash fish from the Columbia. There's a lot of carp population, things like that. And there's also a few crawdads making their way out.
There we go. Oh, he's running at me. There we go. Another little guy. Looks like it's a little buck. Want to get out of there. Got the little cut on his tail. Probably just started fanning not too long ago. So that's a good sign. Tells me they're just starting. So these fish right now are kind of pairing up with the females. They're all getting in groups. Usually if you find a female, you'll find at least two males with it. But once they start bedding, you're gonna find just one. You know, find the one mate. Like I was showing earlier, the cut on the tail was telling me that the fish had just started to fan. Well, throughout the year, sediment starts getting on all the rock, you know, light sediment from getting washed down from the river, settles on the rock, so the bass come in, they want a clean bed, and they'll fan it. But during that fanning process, they get cuts and nicks on their tail from this sharp rock, this sedimentary rock, and that's a good sign. You know, it tells you that the fish are up, and if the fish are up, there's fish pre-spawning and there's fish spawning, so there's two groups of fish that we get a target, not just one. And it could extend the day a little bit longer for us. Sometimes when you get a cold pattern and the females are on the bed with the males, well, you get that cold pattern, it'll shove the females off, and you know, occasionally the males will stay behind and the females will push out and suspend in deeper water. So if we're catching just the males now, it's telling me that the bigger fish could come in here a little later as it warms up a bit and the ambient temperature goes up. Or they might not come in at all. So we might just move out and throw some jerk baits and see if we can't get any of the bigger bigger females to commit to a reaction bait and get them going. Liven them up a little bit. Not a very big guy, but this just goes to show how hard they fight. This is a fiberglass rod. He actually pulled a little drag for a little guy.
Welcome back to the Columbia River. I'm Justin Wolf. We're after smallmouth in the Columbia River Gorge with Jeff Abbott and Marcel Clausen, who started off the day in a side pond looking for warmer water, but have since moved out to the main river looking for bigger bass.
So right here on the main river, and what we're looking for are extended underwater points. But not just any extended point, but something that has about, I'd say, a fist-sized rock and just a little bit bigger. Seems to be where most of the crawdads are hiding in. And what it is also doing is when the current's coming down river, it's forcing all that bait over top, and it's bringing all of that onto the backsides of the points. And that's where we're seeming to find most of the smallmouth. So we're just gonna keep hitting the backsides of these submerged points. And as those fish come into stage, for pre-spawning, they'll follow from the tips, and they'll follow these points in, and then they'll go back into their spawning base. So right now we're on those highways where there's a lot of food available, and the current's working just right with the right size rock. If we can just put all those variables together, we can catch some fish. Double hooked, he ain't going nowhere. All right, now that there, is your typical Columbia smallmouth. Healthy, fat, pre-spawn, nothing wrong with the tail. It's up in 3 feet of water. It's exactly what we're looking for. So I threw out the speed trap in a spring craw pattern and put some of that Procure crawdad scent on. And it wasn't just a couple of casts later. That's the result. Nice 3 pound Columbia River smallmouth. Nice fish. Thank you.
There's one.
There you go. Is that on the rattle trap?
Yeah.
It's
a couple feet from shore.
That's a good one. You're gonna catch and make it a good one, right? Oh! That was about 4 pounds.
Yeah.
Yeah, the bite was a little slow this morning. The water temp in the river, main river channel was 52.5 degrees. So that's why we found ourselves going back in the lagoons and trying to find the warmest water we could, which was about 55 to 56. Still a little early, fish weren't bedding yet. So we came back out on the main river. And since that time, the main river's warmed up about 2.5 degrees to 55 as it is now. And it's really started to turn these pre-spawn fish on. So we made the right decision by coming out and working these reaction baits. So now we're starting to catch fish. Got them on the jerk bait. Alright. Cookie cutters. Need to find some more of those big ones. Now the pre-spawn time, fish get really gregarious. Like to travel in groups. Clean tail. Just pre-spawning. It's dark.
Another one. Thanks for watching today's episode of Angler West TV. You know, it's only with the sponsor support that the show is made possible, so please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.